Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh and we are going to start with our daily current affairs. So today you have 16th of April 2021 and as you know the current affairs and its weightage have been increasing tremendously specifically in the civil services examination, right, which is conducted by the UPSC. For that purpose you have to study the national newspapers like the Hindu, or you can also read the Indian Express. Both of these newspapers are equally good. You can refer any of these newspapers for your better preparation. And these lectures are basically useful for the students who are preparing for the civil services examination. You can supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures also, right? And for that, you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube, that is the Future IAS, right? And you will get the daily current affairs related news, all right? Which has been uploaded on the YouTube on the day-to-day basis. All right. So let's begin with the daily current affairs lecture. Okay. So first is basically related to the Kumbh Mela. As you know about the Kumbh Mela, it is also the largest congregation of the pilgrims, right? Especially, you know, the fakirs or the saints, they basically attended this Kumbh Mela. Even you understand the largest congregation in the world. Right, millions of the people basically attended this Kumbh Mela. Okay, now this Kumbh Mela is basically declared as a festival of the sacred picture by the UNESCO. All right, now it has been made that now the Kumbh Mela, which has been going on, in that Kumbh Mela, the devotee should have the negative RT-PCR test that will to ascertain whether the devotees has, right, the coronavirus, you know, the positive or the negative report, right? So RT-PCR test is basically to conduct, to check whether the person has the COVID-19 virus or not. Okay, so it has been made mandatory that whoever the devotees who would like to attend this Kumbh Mela, they should have negative RT-PCR test in order to enter the Kumbh Mela, which is going on in Haridwar. Okay. Now, the Kumbh Mela, which has been, you know, a largest congregation of the pilgrims, is attended by the millions of the people, right? It is a festival of the sacred picture, okay? And this congregation, where the millions of the people attend this Kumbh Mela, include the ascetics, saints, sadhus, as well as aspirants, right? Like Kalpavavis, visitors also have their presence in the Kumbh Mela. Okay, now what happens is during the Kumbh Mela, right, the participants or the devotees, they take the bath or they take the dip in the sacred river called Ganga, right? So they take the dip in the sacred river, right? And there is also a custom that if once the person take the dip in the sacred river, he can get freed from any sin or from all the sins that he has committed. Right. So thus this type of dip or this type of bath in the sacred water on the sacred river would liberate the person from the cycle of birth and the death. So it is a religious belief. It's a custom that if the person take the dip, he will be freed from the cycle of the virtuous cycle of the birth and the death. Okay. Now this festival of Kumbh Mela is basically held every 4 years in the rotation at four places. So the first is Allahabad, second is Haridwar, third is Ujjain, and fourth is Nasik. These are the four places, right, where the Kumbh Mela is held every 4 years in the rotation. Okay, so as you know that these Kumbh Mela is located at the four different cities, right? Allahabad in UP, Haridwar in Uttarakhand, Ujjain in Madhya Pradesh, Nasik in Maharashtra. So all four cities have their different social and the cultural activities. So obviously this Kumbh Mela making is, you know, this type of congregation or this type of, you know, the association of the people at the four different places, making the Kumbh Mela as culturally diverse festival in the country, right? As I told you that this is held every 4 years by the rotation. That means at any given place, the Kumbh Mela is held once in 12 years, right? So that is 4 years in the rotation. And there is a difference of around 3 years between the Kumbh Melas at the Haridwar and the Nasik, right? And in the Nasik and the Ujjain, the fair is basically held, right, which are celebrated in the same year or generally at the 1 year apart. This is just in customized, you know, the procedure which have been held during the Kumbh Mela. Okay. And in the two places called Haridwar and the Allahabad, the Ardh Kumbh Mela or half Kumbh Mela is held every sixth year. So the full complete Kumbh Mela is held every, you know, every 12 year at the one place, that is a 4 year in the rotation for the four different places, Allahabad, Haridwar, Ujjain and Nasik. But for the two places, Haridwar and Allahabad, the half Kumbh Mela or Ardh Kumbh Mela that is held every sixth year over there. Okay, so you can see here the congregation where the people, ascetics, sadhus, devotees collected, right, at that one place, and they are taking the dip at the holy river Ganga. Okay, next, the annuity clause goes for the NPS subscriber, right? NPS means the National Pension System, which have been, you know, announced by the government of India. Now, there is some annuity clause that the person have to, you know, convert 40% of their accumulated retirement corpus into an annuity. That is, you know, a compulsory provision that they have to convert 40% of their accumulated retirement corpus into an annuity. Right now, the National Pension System, which have made a provision that there is no longer, or there is no need, right, or there will be no compulsion, right, for the investor to convert this 40% of their accumulated retirement corpus into the annuity, right? Because the poor yields and the high inflation is already, you know, causing so much erosion to the income of the investors. So what is happening is it is causing the negative returns, right? As it is held by the Pension Fund Regulatory and the Development Authority, that it is already causing, right, the negative returns to the investors. Now, this Pension Fund Regulatory Development Authority, which is a regulatory body for such funds, would allow saving up to 5 lakh rupees, right? Previously, this was up to 2 lakh rupees, right? So presently the provision is up to the 2 lakh rupees, you can have the saving, right? While, you know, you can take, you know, the whole amount at the retirement, right? So it can have up to the saving up to 5 lakh rupees to take the whole amount at the retirement. Now, the Pension Fund Regulatory and the Development Authority is hoping that, right, this launch would have first guaranteed return on the NPS scheme would be available in the coming year. Okay. And apart from that, the government also has decided to amend the Pension Fund Regulatory Development Authority Act, that is PFRD Act 2013, right, to allow the National Pension Service Scheme members to have the balance over 5 lakh rupees to retain this 40% of the corpus in the NPS. Right, so this will made a provision by amending this PFRDA Act, and it will also wind it down to over few years over the system to, you know, that is basically different from the systematic withdrawal plan. Okay, and in the post retirement, the person has to take 40% of their total corpus as an annuity, as per the current law mandate, and 60% can be commuted or taken up as a lump sum. This is the current provision. Right, the person which is basically post-retirement can have to have this one, right? They have to have 40% of the total corpus in the annuity, right, as per mandate. So the Finance Ministry have already announced this plan to amend this PFRD Act 2013, right, in the budget 2019-20, right? So that will basically override the statutory annuitization program that was basically compulsion to have this 40% of the corpus in the annuity. Okay. Next, the State of World Population Report 2021. As you know that United Nations Population Fund, which is a basically United Nations agency, have basically, you know, brought down a report called the State of World Population Report 2021. Okay, now it is a flagship report which provides, right, the data related to the world population. So this year, the United Nations Population Fund report, the State of World Population Report 2021, is titled as My Body is My Own, right, which is the title of this year's report, was basically launched. Okay, now this is the first time when the United Nations basically, you know, focusing on the bodily autonomy. The bodily autonomy means the person's autonomy, right, the person's bodily autonomy. Here we have some sort of a, you know, the gender discrimination aspect or some sort of a gender empowerment aspect which have been brought down by the United Nations. So bodily autonomy, you must understand in the sense is that most of the female, around 50% or more than 50% of the female, do not have the bodily autonomy. That means it is defined as the power and the agency to make the choice about your body, right? What type of choices, right? The choices regarding the contraceptions, the choices regarding the healthcare services, the choices regarding when to do sex or the sexual autonomy, right? So all such things are considered under the bodily autonomy, right? So this year's, the United Nations Population Fund report of the state of world population is mainly focusing on the autonomy of the person, right? That is, my body is my own. That is the title for this year, right? Without having any fear of violence or someone else decide for your body. You have to have your own autonomy to decide on your body. So here, the United Nations Population Fund noted that nearly half of the women from 57 developing countries, right, where the data is available, do not have their right to make the decisions. The right to make the decisions in terms of their, you know, the bodily autonomy, in terms of their, you know, when to take the contraceptions, right, seeking healthcare services, even to their sexuality to deny, right, to do sex and something like that. Okay, so here the data also says that the country where the data is available, and only 55% of the women are fully empowered to make the choices over the healthcare. 45% of the women are not empowered to take the choices over healthcare, like contraceptions and ability to say yes or no to the sex. Okay, so that shows that the bodily autonomy is not been there to the 45% of the women, especially in those countries. And the report also says that only 75% of the countries legally ensure the full and equal access to the contraceptions. That means around 25% of the countries do not ensure the full and equal section access to the contraception. This is also one of the aspect of the freedom to you know, to the woman, and also the one of the aspect of the gender, you know, empowerment. Now, some examples you can take of the violation of the bodily autonomy, like you have the child marriages. The child marriages are conducted openly, specifically in the Rajasthan, Haryana, right? These states where child marriages are very rampant. So this is also affect the bodily autonomy of the person, because in the very tender age, if you married the children, like what will happen? They don't have their choice. The female genital mutilation, this is also one of the aspects. Right. This is also a, you know, an offense. Now, lack of contraceptive choices leading to the unplanned pregnancy, because if you do not provide legally availability of the contraceptive, what will happen? Right. There will be unplanned pregnancy. Right. And the especially the women do not have, right, the regulation on their own bodily autonomy. Right. Then you have the unwanted sex exchange for the home and for food, when the people with diverse sexual orientation and the gender identity cannot walk down the street without fearing assault and the humiliation. So that is also one aspect, that there is a you know, some sort of a gender identities which are cannot be openly disclosed, otherwise you may face some sort of a humiliation or assault on you. Okay, and this is also, you know, this type of aspect also stripped off the person, right, of the right of self-determination, right, to live the life free from any violence, right, and to enjoy the safe and satisfying sexual life. So this is also affecting the bodily autonomy of the person, right? So women around the world are also denied this fundamental right of bodily autonomy, right, with the COVID-19 pandemic further exacerbating this situation, right? Because nowadays, because of COVID-19 pandemic, the women are further dependent on, right, for their bodily autonomy, right, for the male partners specifically. So it is further exacerbating this situation. Okay, so this year United Nations Population Fund have brought down the State of World Population Report 2021 with a title called "The Bodily Autonomy is the Fundamental Right of or Fundamental Human Right." So "My Body is My Own" is the title of that report, which brought the aspect of the bodily autonomy to the woman, which is the important emphasis on the availability of the healthcare aspect, right, the contraceptives, and when to have sex or not, right? That is to say, finally, to that respect. Okay, next, the e-visa. E-visa means electronic visa facility. See, Union Home Ministry has, you know, is the regulatory ministry with respect to the e-visa for the foreigners who can apply for this e-visa, right, for the various purpose. For example, a person who is residing in the foreign country, right, without having to go to the respective embassies in their country, they can apply for the electronic visa facility, which is online available, right, for the various categories. So currently, the India provides the five types of the e-visa facilities. That is the tourist, business, conferences, for medical purpose, for medical attending purpose, right? So because of this COVID-19 pandemic, the country, India, has suspended this electronic visa facility. But now, because of the surge of this, you know, the COVID-19 cases again, the India has opened, or India has restored this electronic visa facilities for the foreigners from 156 countries, right? So from 156 countries, the person or the foreigners are eligible to apply for the electronic visa, right? Who is basically intending to visit the India only for the four purposes. The fifth purpose have not been opened. That is the tourist. So that is the e-visa is not available to the tourist, right, which have not been restored yet because of coronavirus pandemic. But for the other four categories, that is your business, conferences, medical reasons, as well as medical attendance, for that purpose, right, the person can apply from this 156 country for the electronic visa. And the e-visa is not available right away for basically for the tourism purpose. For that, you have to approach for the individual embassy. Okay. So as I told you, this e-visa is available for the five categories, that is tourist, business, conference, medical, and medical attendant. Okay. And a foreigner can apply only for the 4 days prior to the travel. And that is, once he applied the 4 days prior to the travel, right, the respective, the officials with the electronic visa, they will verify the details. And an electronic travel authorization, that is ETA, is generated. This ETA will have to be presented at the immigration check post. This immigration check post have been identified, have been nominated by the immigration agencies in India, right? That will be checked, right? That will be checking all necessary documents that are required for the electronic travel authorization. So here, the entry of a person from these 156 countries will be allowed only at 28 designated international airports. So person can enter, right, in India only through this 28 designated international airports, right? If the person is traveling through the electronic travel authorization visa, and the five major seaports are open also for this purpose, right? Previously, this facility was available to the 171 countries before restrictions that was announced in 2020, but now this facility is only restored to the 156 countries. Currently, there are few or there are many countries which are already put under the restrictions. For example, the UK, Canada, Hong Kong, Indonesia, Iran, Malaysia, Saudi Arabia are the basically not in the list that are eligible for having this electronic visa facility. So they are also the notable exclusions which have been made, right, for the purpose, which have been made for the purpose of, you know, this electronic visa facility, right? This relaxation which have been made by the Union Home Ministry, Government of India, in the wake of deadly second wave of COVID-19 pandemic around the world. Okay, next is Afghanistan. As you know, Afghanistan is a country. Now, Afghanistan has the problem with respect to the insurgency terrorism, right? The Al-Qaeda and Taliban are basically two stakeholders in the Afghanistan. They are fighting for their domination in the Afghanistan. Currently, the Taliban-led government is basically, having the strong say in the Afghanistan. Now, the Taliban is also one of the important stakeholder in the peace process of the Afghanistan. Apart from that, there are other regional powers also, which are backed by the neighboring countries like Pakistan. So Al-Qaeda is basically backed by the Pakistan, right, which is also destabilizing the country called Afghanistan. So now what happens is, the previous president, Mr. Donald Trump, has already announced that there will be conditional withdrawal of the troops. Now you must understand, there are around 2,000 to 3,000 troops, right, of the US troops are currently stationed in Afghanistan. And there are more than 8,000 troops from the NATO, which is also stationed in Afghanistan. Now, they are there in the Afghanistan for the security purpose, because there are a lot of, you know, the activities like terrorism activities, insurgency activities are openly there. And there is a threat to the world community from such terrorism activities. All right. So the Donald Trump already announced that there will be troops withdrawal from Afghanistan, but that will be conditional. That will be conditional. The Donald Trump announced that the troop withdrawal from Afghanistan will begin by May 1st, 2021. But that is conditional. Conditional is that the Donald Trump has made very clear that the conditional withdrawal will be subjected to the Taliban has to take the steps to prevent the Al-Qaeda, right, from sheltering in the Afghanistan. So Al-Qaeda should not take the shelter in the Afghanistan, and Taliban has to ensure for that. And second, right, the Taliban will also agree to the dialogue on the sharing of the power with the Afghanistan government, right? So these are the two important conditions which have been imposed by the Donald Trump administration at that point of the time. Taliban will ensure that no groups like Al-Qaeda will take the shelter in the Afghanistan. And second, the Taliban will also take, you know, some sort of a dialogue for the power sharing for the formation of Afghanistan government. But the new president called, you know, basically, or, you know, Joe Biden have announced that there will be unconditional withdrawal, right? That means the Joe Biden have not put any conditions for the withdrawal of their troops. So Joe Biden have formally announced that the US troops will withdraw from Afghanistan by September 11, 2021. That is, complete withdrawal will be taken by September 11, 2021. The September 11 is basically most important because it is the 20th anniversary, right, where 9/11 attacks were basically carried out in the USA by basically some of the extremist group or some of the terrorist groups, right, specifically the Al-Qaeda. So Al-Qaeda was behind of attacking these, you know, these basically on the USA, right, with the help of the basically aircrafts, right? So the aircrafts were basically collided with the Pentagon or with those, you know, the Twin Towers, and which has ultimately led to the collapse of these towers. Okay, now, as I told you that there are around 2,500 to 3,500 US troops in the Afghanistan, plus there are around 8,000 troops of the NATO. Now, with that push or with that announcement, there will be a coordinated withdrawal that will be expected from the Afghanistan soon, right? So now there will be, you know, a vacuum that will be created, because now the US and the NATO forces are basically training the Afghanistan, you know, military as well as the police forces, right, for the purpose of the security, for the purpose of basically, you know, maintaining the security after they leave. So here the US and NATO have already spent billions of the dollars for basically maintaining this peace and the security in the region. Now the peace talks are also struggling, and insurgency is also very resilient. So this has again put a question mark on the withdrawal of the US and the NATO forces at that point of the time when the insurgency is very resilient in the region, right? So the September 11 is basically a most important date, as a symbolic date, when it will be completed the 20 years of the Al-Qaeda, which attacked the US, right, with the help of these hijacked airliners, and which has ultimately triggered the military intervention from the US and the NATO, specifically in the Afghanistan. So, you know, the mission which we have started called Resolute Support. This Resolute Support is basically the NATO's current mission, right? Through the Resolute Support, the NATO and the US forces are basically training and equipping the Afghan security forces, right, so that they can fight with Islamist Taliban group as well as the Al-Qaeda group in the country, which are basically trying to, you know, disturb the peace and the tranquility in the country. Okay, then you have the Arzachid Petrosos, right? The Arzachid Petrosos are basically a reptile. It is giant reptile which is having the long neck, and this giant reptile also have, you know, the ability to flew in the sky. And this Azadarchid Pteropod basically lived on the earth around 65 million years ago. So this pterosaur, which is a basically a giant reptile, used to live on the earth around 65 million years before, right? But now it has been extinct. It is, you know, having the neck, which is longer than the giraffe. The giraffe currently has the on an average 6 feet long neck. So the pterosaurs, which is a basically, you know, a reptile, have the neck, which is even larger than this 6 feet, which is the largest, you know, neck with respect to the giraffe. Now, the researchers as well as the scientists have reported that this long neck, which is found in the species of the pterosaur, which is a reptile, right, which will be supported by this thin neck vertebrae, right, which is supported by this integrated internal structure, right, which are not seen in any other species before. Okay, and these pterosaurs are basically reptiles, which are close cousin of the dinosaurs. Right, and it is the first animal after insect that evolved this powerful flight. So they were able to flew also, right? And they were extinct around 65 to 66 million years ago, right? Which is the end of the Cretaceous period, right? And this pterosaurs are one type of pterosaur, which is distinguishing characteristics, right? They can especially having the long necks, right, which is basically, you know, adapted to the different conditions. So like that pterosaurs you have, so you have a long neck and they can also flew in the sky also. Next, the Ponzi scheme. See, the Ponzi scheme is basically the name of the scheme, which is basically, you know, the fraudulent scheme. What is fraudulent scheme? So here, through this Ponzi scheme, what will happen, right? The investors are basically lured. Right, they were basically lured or they were attracted toward the scheme by a fraud. So here they were paid profits to the earlier investors. So through the Ponzi schemes, what will happen? You have to bring more and more investors. So you have to bring, right? You have to help the joining of more and more investors in this Ponzi scheme, and the early investor will be paid profits, right? With the help of these investments. So what will happen? The scheme leads to, you know, the victims who were basically joined this Ponzi schemes, right? They were basically, you know, made to believe that the income or the profits are coming from the legitimate business activities, but they are not really, right? They were made to believe that this investment or the profit, right, which were coming from the legitimate business, right? And they were also remain unaware about the investors that were basically a source of the fund. So what will happen once the source of the fund cuts, right? This Ponzi scheme completely collapsed and all money which have been invested by the investors, they have completely lost. So what happens is the Bernie Madoff, which is basically a Wall Street financier, who were sentenced also to the 150 years of the prison or sentence, have been convicted for being the largest and the most devastating Ponzi scheme in the USA in the any financial history of the world. And the Bernie Madoff recently died in the US. So the Ponzi scheme, as I explained you, that it is a form of fraud where the investors are lured by the promoters of this Ponzi schemes and they were paid a profit by, you know, to the early investors with the fund that were basically, you know, recently been invested by the new investors, right? And the schemes would basically ultimately made to the belief of the victims that these funds or these profits are coming from the legitimate business activities, and they were forced to have, right, to have the investment with respect to these funds. Now there will be, you know, the Ponzi schemes which are totally rely on the constant flow of new investment, which is again the new investors would join over the period of the time, and these new investors would continue to provide the return to the older investors. So new investor will come that will provide the fund to the older investor. The older investor help the new investor to join this Ponzi schemes more and more, and that is how this flow of the fund basically carried out, right? And once this flow of the fund basically stops, the scheme fall apart. Right. So this Ponzi scheme basically named after, or it is coined after, right, the Charles Ponzi in 1990, right, which was the first time this type of scam or this type of investment scam was traced back to late 1800s. And that point of the time, it was named as a Ponzi scheme. So here, the scheme was named after the Charles Ponzi, who was basically duped thousands of the investors or thousands of the American investors in the USA, right, in respect of this postage stamp scheme in 1920. So what is the Ponzi scheme? I told you that. Here, it is an investment scheme where you will be invited to invest in the scheme, right? And you will be offered to believe that this flow of the money is coming from the legitimate business, right? And that they will offer you the high amount of the profits, right? And they will ask you to inform other investors, to join other investors, and you will be paid this money from these funds from that will be coming from the new investors. So the funds to you will be paid from the new investors rather than the profits earned. But you will be believed that, or you will be made to believe that this return is coming from the profits rather than the new investors. Okay. And the investors receive the payouts, and that will basically encourage the older investors to search for the new investors, right? To invest more and more. And their older investors also invest more and more in that Ponzi scheme. And as I told you that this whole scheme is based on the inflow of the money or inflow of the investors. So what happens is once this flow of this investment, collapse, this whole Ponzi scheme also collapse. So that is how, right, this scheme also collapsed over the period of the time. Next, the Punjab's new nutrient-rich crop and the vegetable varieties. So here, the Punjab have come up, right, with the improved crop and the vegetable varieties, right? These improved crop and the vegetable varieties are basically rich in terms of nutrients. So here, they are called as the PAU, that is Punjab Agricultural University 1 Chapati, right, which is having the low polyphenols as well as which is having the outstanding processing qualities. Now, this PAU 1 Chapati have been shortlisted for the commercialization. Now the wheat candidate varieties, which is having the high grain protein, high zinc content, low phytates, high carotenoids, right, have been developed. So this is what a different varieties have been developed, right, which is having the high nutrient in terms of the high grain protein, high zinc, low phytates, high carotenoids, right, which have been selected for that purpose, right. Besides, the Punjab Agricultural University has also offered, right, the two varieties of, the tomato. So here they have been offered, right, to the growers, the two carotene rich cherry tomatoes varieties, right, which are also known as the Punjab Sona and Punjab Kesar. They are basically the two different varieties of the cherry tomato, which is having, the carotene rich varieties of tomato, as well as the Punjab Agricultural University also offered, right, the two, anthocyanin rich brinjal varieties also, which are also known as Punjab Ronak and Punjab Bharpur, right, which is having the high amount of antioxidant properties. So Punjab Agricultural University has then offered the two varieties of the tomato, which are also having the rich carotene, right, which is also known as the Punjab Sona and Punjab Kesar, and two brinjal varieties, which are rich in terms of the anthocyanin, right, which is basically also known as the Punjab Ronak and Punjab Bharpur, which is having high antioxidant properties. Okay, now these varieties and the genetic stocks that have been developed by Punjab Agricultural University with the help of other agencies like the promotion of university research and the scientific excellence, which provided the grant, right? And that is basically provided by the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India, for the purpose of promotion of these varieties. Okay, next, let's understand National Internet Exchange of India. Okay, so this National Internet Exchange of India is basically an initiative of, by the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology, that is called MeitY, have inaugurated these three initiatives for the National Internet Exchange of India. So the first initiative is basically known as IPV6 expert panel, that is also known as IP group. So first of all, you must understand what is this IP. IP means Internet Protocol. Internet Protocol. What is this Internet Protocol? Internet Protocol is simple. It is a principal communication protocol in the Internet Protocol suite, right? So it is basically for the relying of the datagrams across the network boundary. So it will be, you know, routing functions that enable the internet working and essentially establish the internet. So IP has a task of delivering this packet, right? The packet of, you know, the basically, you know, the data from the source to the host and ultimately to the destination, right? And the host, you know, solely rely or solely based on this IP address in the packet headers. So it is basically also known as IP or Internet Protocol, that is IP. Now, what is this IP6? IP6 is the most recent version of Internet Protocol, which is also a communication protocol that provides the identification and location system for the computers on the network, right? And that will also route the traffic across this internet. So what is IPS? This IPv6 is basically developed by the Internet Engineering Task Force, right? Which is to deal the long anticipated problem of the previous version of the Internet Protocol, that is Internet Protocol version 4, right? So Internet Protocol version 6 is intended to replace this Internet Protocol version of 4, which is being currently having a lot of problem. So this three initiatives which have been inaugurated by the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology for the National Internet Exchange of India is one aspect is IPv6. So IP group is basically a group to extend the support to the all Indian entities, right, who are finding is technically challenging to migrate and to adopt this IPv6. So as I told you that this IPv6 is basically intent to resolve the problem that were basically previously facing by the users or by the Indian entity with respect to the IPv6. So this IP group will basically help the Indian entities to finding, you know, some sort of a solution for this technically challenging and to adopt this IPv6, which is basically a new version of Internet Protocol. So it is a joint effort by the Department of Telecommunication, the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology, and the community, which is basically promoting the IPv6 or Internet Protocol version, you know, the sixth version in our country. So here, the expert panel group will comprise the members from both government and the private organization, right, with respect to the promotion of this IPv6, expert panel. Next, the NICSI Academy. See, the NICSI Academy is created for the purpose of providing this technical education, right, or to educate the person, right, that in terms of technical, in terms of non-technical, right. Ultimate aim of this NICSI Academy to educate the person, to allow the learning, to the people, specifically to the new technology like IPv6, right, which are normally not taught in the educational institutions. So the NICSI Academy will allow or would enable the persons to learn this technical or non-technical aspect of the Internet Protocol version 6, right? Because such type of Internet Protocol version 6 is not generally taught in the educational institutions. Next, you have the NICSI IP Index. This NICSI IP Index basically is also developed by NICSI, which is a NICSI Academy, okay? And this IPv6 index portal for the internet community. So this NICSI IP Index portal will showcase, right, different IPv6 adoption rate in our country and across the world. So what is the rate for the adoption for this IPv6 or the next version of Internet Protocol is being showcased through this NICSI IP Index that will be shown to the people. Okay, so that is the three important aspects which will be promoted by the MeitY to the National Internet Exchange of India. Okay, next, the National Startup Advisory Council. Now, this National Startup Advisory Council has been promoted by the Ministry of Commerce and Industry. So the Union Minister of Commerce and Industry, Mr. Piyush Goyal, had chaired the first meeting of National Startup Advisory Council. So what is that? What is the purpose of this National Startup Advisory Council? So first of all, the Department of Promotion of Industry and Internal Trade have constituted this National Startup Advisory Council. The main purpose of this National Startup Advisory Council is to take the measures that are needed to build a strong ecosystem for nurturing innovation and the startups in the country, because that will be needed for the industrial development, for the economic development of our country, and also that will also drive the sustainable economic growth in our country. And definitely such type of innovation and startup in our country would definitely generate the large scale employment opportunities in our country also. So that will be beneficial, right, for the long term development, for the long term economic growth, for the larger scale employment opportunities in our country. So to advise on the government, to advise to the government on these measures, the National Startup Advisory Council was basically set up to promote the startups innovation, to promote the startup, in our country, right? To promote and facilitate these startups and innovation in our country. So besides the ex-officio members, the council also has the number of non-ex-officio members, right? And this National Startup Advisory Council would have the various stakeholders, like you have the founders of the successful startups, which have already set up their startup and that have been running successfully. That will also have the veterans that have grown and scaled up companies in our country, right? And that will also consist of the persons who are capable of representing the interest of the investors into basically the startups, right? That will also have the invitees, specifically the person who are capable of representing the interest of the incubators and the accelerators, right? That will have also the representation of the associations of the stakeholders for the startups. And that will also have the representatives of the industry associations that will be ultimately benefit the development of this, you know, startup ecosystem in our country and to promote further innovation, economic development, and to facilitate the large scale investment and to large scale employment opportunities in our country. Okay, so this is what the startup which has been shown with the help of this diagram. Okay, so that's all for today. Thank you very much. We'll meet again tomorrow for our next current affairs. Thank you very much.